Good evening and welcome to Just the News. I'm Amita Balachandra. I'm standing in for Faye today. Let's get started. The top story is Union Health Ministry on Thursday has said that there is a steady decline in COVID cases since May 7th, where India saw over 4 lakh cases. This is what the Health Ministry's Joint Secretary Lava Agarwal has said, and I quote, "The recovery rate on May 3rd was at 81.8%, which went up to 85.6% on May 18th, and at present, the rate is at 90%, end quote. India reported 2.11 lakh COVID cases and 3,847 deaths as of Wednesday. Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Karnataka and Maharashtra remained the worst affected states. On to some other news now. Amid the tussle between the government and social media giants over India's new IT rules, Twitter today has said and responded that it would strive to comply with applicable law in India. It's also requested the government to consider a minimum of 3 months extension in order for them to implement the rules. In a statement, Twitter has said, and I quote, "Right now we're concerned by recent events regarding our employees in India and the potential threat to freedom of expression for the people we serve. We, alongside many in civil society in India and around the world, have concerns and regards to the use of intimidation tactics by the police in response to enforcement of our global terms of service as well as with core elements of the new IT rules. We plan to advocate for changes to elements of these regulations that inhibit free, open, public conversation. We will continue our constructive dialogue with the Indian government and believe it is critical to adopt a collaborative approach. It is the collective responsibility of elected officials, industry, and civil societies to safeguard the interests of the public," end quote. Now, the new IT guidelines for social media intermediaries are aimed at making entities such as Google, Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp and other OTT sites more accountable and responsible for the content hosted on the platforms. Now, to give you a bit of a background of what's happened, on 25th of February, the center had announced new intermediary rules and provided a 3-month compliance window that ended on the 25th of May. Post this, WhatsApp on Wednesday moved Delhi High Court challenging these rules, which needs them to make provisions for identification of the first originator of the information. The petition filed before the court by WhatsApp claims that the government's rules can only be implemented if WhatsApp breaks its end-to-end encryption to all its users. Now, the government, in response to this on Wednesday, said that it respects the right to privacy and has no intention to violate it. In the meantime, while there have been a lot of conjecture on what will happen to these social media giants, Union Minister of Electronics and Information Technology Ravi Shankar Prasad has said, taking to Twitter, clarifying that ordinary citizens need not fear about these new rules. He has also put out a statement that says, and I quote, "Government fully recognizes and respects the right to privacy. Ordinary users of WhatsApp have nothing to fear about the new rules. The entire objective is to find out who started the message that led to commissioning of specific crimes mentioned in the rules," end quote. He also went on to say that the obligation to reveal the first originator of an offensive message already in circulation relates only to offenses relating to sovereignty, integrity and security of India, public order, rape, child sexual abuse. That too when other less intrusive measures are not effective. The rules only empower the ordinary users of social media when they become victims of abuse and misuse," end quote. In a virtual conference with select reporters in Asia Pacific, Google CEO Sundar Pichai has said that Google will comply with India's new intermediary rules. He said, and I quote, "It's obviously very early days and our local teams are very engaged. We always respect local laws in every country we operate in and we work constructively. We have clear transparency reports when we comply with government requests. We also highlight that in our transparency reports. He added that a free and open internet is foundational and that India has long traditions of that. He also said that the company respects the legislative processes and in cases where it needs pushback, it does so. It's a balance we have struck around the world, he said. Also in the news, Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal has urged the center to procure Pfizer COVID vaccine as soon as possible to inoculate children in the national capital and across the country. Now this comes after PTI reported that Pfizer has told the government its COVID vaccine shows high effectiveness against the India dominant variant. Pfizer also has told the government that its vaccine had been proven suitable for everybody over the age of 12 and can be stored for a month in cold storage facilities with a temperature range of 2 to 8 degrees Celsius. Moving on now, West Bengal has extended its COVID restrictions till the 15th of June. West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee has said, and I quote, "Please don't call this a lockdown. COVID numbers have come down. For economy's sake, there will be no total lockdown," end quote. West Bengal in the meantime has reported 16,225 cases and 153 deaths as of Wednesday. Meanwhile, Mamata Banerjee has said that class 12 board examinations will be held in the last week of July, while the tests for class 10 will take place in mid-August. The dates for both the exams will be announced later. Also in other news, days after Mehul Choksi, the 62-year-old fugitive wanted by the CBI and ED in connection with the 14,000 crore rupee Punjab National Bank loan fraud and money laundering case, was reportedly missing from Antigua. News agency ANI has cited Antigua Prime Minister Gaston Browne that Choksi, who was captured in Dominica, will be repatriated to India. Browne said that Dominica has agreed to Choksi's repatriation and Antigua will not accept him back. According to ANI, the Antigua Prime Minister has said, and I quote, "Dominica has agreed, we'll not accept him back. He made a monumental error for skipping the island. Dominican government and law enforcement are cooperating and we have informed Indian government to have him repatriated to India," end quote. On the other hand, Mehul Choksi's lawyer Vijay Agarwal has asserted that Choksi can't be repatriated to India as there is an Antiguan High Court order restraining processing any request from India. He said, and I quote, "It has to be done legally and it is not a game of chess. We are dealing with a human being and nor a pawn that shall be placed here or there, and it cannot be on somebody's desires and whims," end quote. Also, according to PTI, a Dalit man in Gujarat's Ahmedabad, Suresh Vaghela, was allegedly attacked by 11 men for sporting a long mustache. Now, the police on Monday said 3 people have been arrested so far. The man's FIR also stated that the group gathered outside his house on Sunday night and hurled casteist slurs over his mustache. Now, Deputy Superintendent of Police DS Vyas has said that 22-year-old is undergoing treatment in the hospital. Let's now take a look at what's making news in the world of business. Petrol prices have surged for the 14th time this month alone. For the first time, petrol price in Jaipur has breached the 100 rupee mark. It's now 100.17 rupees per litre. Earlier this month, Madhya Pradesh's Bhopal became the first state capital where petrol price cost 100 rupees per litre. In Mumbai, petrol price is nearing the 100 rupee mark. It is at 99.94 rupees per litre, and in Delhi it costs 93.68 rupees per litre. Now, to give you a bit of a context, the fuel prices differ from state to state depending on local taxation, also known as the VAT or value added tax, and freight charges. Apart from this, the central government charges an excise duty on auto fuel as well. Let's now take a look at what's making news across the world. Tens of thousands of people have been evacuated from the city of Goma in the Democratic Republic of Congo with fears of another volcanic eruption. Now, the BBC has reported that local authorities have said that Mount Nyiragongo could erupt once again with little warning. According to the UN, the volcano, which is about 10 kilometers away from Goma, spewed lava over the weekend, killing 32 people and leaving thousands homeless. Reports have also said that the area has been rattled by aftershocks, destroying several buildings. On to sports news now. Zinedine Zidane has resigned as Real Madrid's coach with immediate effect. This comes after the club were beaten to the La Liga title by the Atletico Madrid. Now, in a statement, the club has said, and I quote, "It is now time to respect his decision and show our appreciation for his professionalism, dedication and passion throughout all these years and for what he represents as his figure for Real Madrid," end quote. Now, before we wrap up the news segment, I'll leave you with a bit of positive news. For the first time in 228 years of its history, the Louvre Museum will be headed by a woman, Laura de Kars. Now, Kars was appointed to the museum's president director on Wednesday by French President Emmanuel Macron. Louvre is one of the world's largest art museum and houses the Mona Lisa, among other famous paintings. That's it on the news. Thank you so much for watching.